Hello, everybody. Welcome. Thank you for having me here. And welcome, and thank you for joining at home as well. So, unboring your stories. I thought it would be rude of me to start a storytelling session without telling you a story. So, I wanted to tell you this story, and it's the story, the unforgotten hero of the chalk. So chalk actually dates back to prehistoric times. It was found used in cave drawings. It then worked its way into ancient, here you go, that's better, into our ancient scriptures as well. And then finally, in the late 1800s, it made its way onto chalk boards. So it's quite phenomenal, really, when you think it's played such a huge role in our history. It's shared really important lessons have been used and transferred using chalk. Actually, some of the hardest mathematical equations have used chalk. And we've even sent rockets up into space using chalk. And now, of course, we've got PowerPoint. But we go on, and today you normally find chalk now used in a bit more of a creative sense, don't you? So outside cafes and advertisements, or on streets as well within artwork. So it's actually pretty much come full circle. But the point here is that chalk and stories have both been around since the start of time. And chalk has been a tool that's helped us express ourselves and our thoughts and our visions and our feelings. And ultimately, it's played a huge part of our history. And that's why we call it his story. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. We're going to be talking about your stories. So, like chalk, in this session, what I'm going to be giving you guys is some tools, some tips and tricks, and I'm going to get you to participate as well, so actually practice some ways in which we can help unboring your stories and help you deliver them with more impact. But first of all, an introduction to myself. So my name is Kate Munday, and I founded Out the Box Speakers during lockdown because I wanted to help people on their storytelling journeys. What I realized is we're all innate storytellers. We're living in one big narrative here, but we sometimes just forget to do the thinking, and we end up telling a bit like an eight-year-old telling a joke. Bit disjointed, not much structure, and you might find the punchline like somewhere in the middle. So we just got to do a bit more of the thinking. But really, us, when we are kids, we've got these amazing imaginations, right? We're creating and building things and going off and exploring. And it's very much the same with storytelling. In fact, they did that study with 20 kids, and they asked them, what do you want to be when you grow up? And they said things like, astronaut, I want to be prime minister so I can change the world. And then they went back 20 years later and interviewed the same children. And they were in office jobs or working as dentists. So what happened in between? What went on there? And I think it's very much the same as what we're like in the corporate world. We go into the corporate world, and it's almost like we get this creativity trodden out of us. We get given the hymn sheet to sing from, and then we're just telling the same old boring stories. So it's my mission today to help go from this boring white chalk and to inject some colour back into your stories. That's going to be my mission today. But without any further ado, I would like to see a raise of hands. Who here has heard a boring story before? Yeah? We all have. I definitely have. I'd like you to raise the other hand. Who has told a boring story before? Who's going to admit it? Yes. I definitely have as well. That is no doubt. So I guess what makes a boring story? Because they're far too common, right? We need to understand what makes a boring story. I'd like you to raise your right arm if you think it is the story itself. Or raise your left arm, I'm going to do it mirroring you guys, if you think it is the storyteller Or raise both arms if you think it is both. Yes. Okay, great. Well, I can assure you that it is both. I've been working for some of the biggest corporations and I've heard lots of different stories, and it definitely is both. The good news, however, though, in the last 8 years whilst I've been working for Google, I've been teaching and learning to storytell more impactfully, both the person and the storyteller. And the good news is it can be learned. So that is exactly what we're going to do today. So without any further ado, what is the first story that we tell when we meet somebody? Your introduction, name, exactly. So that's what I'm going to get you guys to do right now. So turn to the person next to you. And you are going to have exactly 1 minute each to do your introductions and switch. That's okay. Perfect. Off you go. Brilliant. Thank you very much. How did we find that? Anybody want to share? We find it okay? Thumbs up, thumbs down. It's all right. Okay, yeah, good. Brilliant. Okay. Well, there's a reason why I did ask you to do that. Personally, if I think back to the most boring stories, I think it's people's introductions. I really do. It's like, hi, I'm John, and I've worked in X company for X years, and I do X role. And it's the same generic formula that everybody seems to copy and paste. And it's super unmemorable. I've got, has anybody else here struggle with remembering people's names? I definitely do. So tell me your boring introduction. I'm definitely going to forget your name. So, and in business, we want to be memorable, right? What is the point if we're not memorable? So if I think about the best storyteller, it's, for me, it has to be Steve Jobs. I don't know if any of you guys have seen him talk. If you haven't, go on YouTube and have a little look. But he's phenomenal. He draws the audience in. He gives elements of surprise. He gives you, in like, gifts right there in the moment. He talks about benefits rather than features. He does so many of the fundamental things to land a really, really good story. But why do we tell stories? So ultimately, there's lots of different reasons. It could be to inform, educate, or entertain. But we want to bring people on this journey with us, don't we? We want to see this story arc that you can see here. And ultimately, at the end of it, we want them to take action. We want some kind of behavioral shift or change. And really, everything's got a story. If you think about X Factor these days, everybody's got a story, don't they? Or if it's just Mama's little bakery down the road. She's also where she's passed on her recipes through generations. Everything has a story which lures us in and makes us more attracted. And a really good book, one of my favorite books, Made to Stick, says that concrete ideas make people believe, emotional ideas make people care, but the right story can help people take action. So that's really what we want to focus on today. What is the right story? And actually, this was something that was looked into a little bit more by Rob Walker and Joshua Glenn, who talked about the Significant Objects Project. So they talked about when you walk into somebody's home, it's always the weird object on the shelf that's got the best story. So they proved this, right? What they went away and did is they bought 100 objects. And then they got 200 of the best writers around the world to write stories for those objects. And then they auctioned them on eBay. And you can see here that actually they bought them for about £120 and they end up selling them for over 3,000% increased value. So it just shows when you add a story, you can really add value to what you're saying. And that kind of makes sense. When we tell facts and figures, we actually only ignite 2 different parts of our brain. But when we tell stories, we ignite 7 different parts of our brain. So if you've ever heard a story and you thought, God, I just feel like we're on the same wavelength there. That is genuinely a thing. This is what we call neurocoupling or mirroring. And basically, your neurons fire when somebody's telling you a story. And if they are mirroring the person who's telling you the story, then that's exactly what you get. And that's what we want to create with our audience, right? This synchronicity. And a way of doing that is getting people to relate to you. So, yeah, it's on the screen. So stories, we don't like the stories where people get up and they start bragging about themselves, do they? You're just like, oh, switch off. Like, don't want to hear about that. You want to hear, we love it when the underdog wins. When the underdog wins or somebody turns their life around. Like, they're the exciting stories that we get bought into. And that's really one of the ways in which we can make stories more impactful. And another book that I like, How to Win Friends and Influence People. Yeah, feeling a few nods. They talk about this as well. They talk about that people buy from friends. We're all human at the end of the day. And in business, we sometimes forget this. We actually forget that all of us have loved, lost, we've got joys, we've felt sadness, we've done lots of the similar things. So I guess it's just understanding our audience better. And how can we relate to them in those sense and get them on those neuro-mirroring wavelengths? But I guess the most important thing here is to be authentic. So I'm going to get you now to do a bit of your story as well. Of course, you could think about the stories that have made you laugh in the past and might actually get some resonance that way. I normally do that, to be honest. I normally, a bit of self-deprecation, tell somebody one of my dating stories. That's a way to get somebody to laugh, to be honest. But you could either go for the laugh or you could actually go for that hardship and how you've turned things around. So we're going to do this exercise now, 2 minutes on the clock. And for you guys, just to jot down, if you haven't got a pen and paper, do it on your phone. And brilliant. Yes, so 2 minutes. And what you're going to jot down is basically what stories can you think of that make you relatable? I know you could probably keep writing forever, couldn't you? You could keep going. But if I gave you an hour to do this, you'd take an hour. If I gave you 2 minutes, you'd take 2 minutes. So there you go. Hopefully you've got some ideas jotted down about those relatable stories. Oh, so the next bit then, I guess, to make it your stories impactful is about memorability. So we talk about the peacock story. How do you stand out from other people? And at Google, we actually talk about your googly facts. That's the first thing they get you to do when you come in, is you have to stand up in front of all of your peers and tell your googly fact. But I get why they do it. It's nerve-wracking. But I get why they do it, because it's all about how are you standing out for somebody else? What is going to make you remembered other than that generic formula that we talked about at the start? So really beyond that, though, there's a few things. People are only really going to remember 3 things about your talk, so keep it simple. And that also goes for the terminology you use. I'm dyslexic, and I sometimes like to cover that up by overcomplicating it, throwing some big words in there to make me seem like I'm not dyslexic. But keep it simple and short and sweet. Then also, we need to talk about details. So what they say in this Made to Stick book is that details are super important. It's why things like fables and myths have been carried on for so many generations and years, because it's the details that make it really relatable and, memorable as well. And then the last thing out of the 3 things that I want you to remember is your emotion and tonality. So when you're telling back these stories, we can add lots of variety and tones to draw people in emotionally. And so that's what I'm going to get you guys to try now. So another exercise, but this, of course, is about how you're going to make things memorable. So what does make you stand out about those stories? Underline them. Maximum of 3 things. Doesn't have to be. Might just be 1 thing. Let's keep it business related as well, if we can, those stories. Try and weave them into a business context. We also need to think about keeping it simple. What are the 3 things? We also need to think about the detail as well, of course. And then, I guess, what's that point that you want to land? And how do you land that with some tonality? Have a little think about that anyway. So we're going to give you how many minutes on the clock? 2 minutes. Thank you very much. You survived. Good. Because we're going to now practice this again, but in person. And those of you who are at home, if you do have a person to speak to, obviously grab them and utilize this opportunity. If not, speak to yourself. I do that often. Or you can obviously just write it out again if you so wish. But again, I would like you to take 2 minutes each to tell your story to somebody else. You're going to actualize it now. So turn to the person next to you. You've got 2 minutes and then switch. Okay, back in the room. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, everybody at home. So that seemed to go well. I heard some laughter going on here, some rubbing shoulders down here. So we did both, right? We did the laughter, got people engaged, and we were being empathetic as well. We got people to relate to us. Yeah, seeing lots of nods. Okay, good. We enjoyed it. I think there's lots of happy faces there. Good, great. Excellent. Well done. And now we're going to progress on to the next bit, which is basically, I was listening to a talk the other day by one of the best Toastmasters, I think he classifies himself as, in the world, potentially. But he made this really interesting point, and he said, if anybody's going to listen to you, they're going to ask themselves this one question. What's in it for them? At the end of the day, time is money, and really we want to know, is this going to be a valuable investment of our time, right? So we've got to think about that. We need to think about our audience and think about what value can we deliver to their lives through our stories. Did you know 30 seconds? So it actually takes only 30 seconds for somebody to decide whether they're going to listen to you or not. Are they going to go on their emails, on their phone, or are they going to listen to you? And this is why YouTube ads are 30-second skippable, because you've got that 30 seconds to grab somebody's attention and make a difference. And it is really about getting attention. Think about Anna Wintour, right? Vogue. That's her job. She's got to cut through the noise and decide what is interesting and what's not. And that's really her motto. If you're not interesting, then I'm not interested. But we've got to get people's buy-in as well. And that's where we really want, when we tell stories, for people to go away and, you know, go to their colleagues. Make it water cooler shareable, you know? Talk about it with their colleagues. Say, we've just met this amazing person, super interesting. This is what they're up to. We have to get involved with them. That's what we want. We want to get their buy-in. And last of all, we obviously want them to remember. And the way that we get them to remember is really not so much about the figure or the fact, is about the relationship to that. And you see this done really well, especially with donation advertisements. They talk about, you know, for a cup of coffee that you have every day, you could be actually donating and helping save lives by giving people 30 mosquito nets. And it puts it into perspective, doesn't it? It's like, wow, I could actually just not have that coffee every day and I could help save lives in Africa. So it's more about the relationship side of things. So again, we talk about this at Google as your killer stat. Whenever I made a presentation, I look through the presentation and I think, what's really going to get their buy-in? What's really going to make them act? And then I pull that stat up to the very top of my presentation to draw them in. And that's why in presentations, you normally see a quote or a figure or a keynote speaker at the start, because that's what they're doing. They're creating credibility and they're also luring people in and getting that buy-in early doors. So I want you to find out your killer stats. So we've all got mobile phones, and I'm assuming we all know what Google is. So I'm going to ask you guys now to go and do exactly that. Go and find your killer stat. Good question. So what is your killer stat? Somebody just asked me. They're a bit confused about this. So I'm going to clarify. So we're thinking about our story, right? And then what? Same story. So it's all that story will have been about you and making you relatable. Or maybe that you've got a purpose within that story. You want to land a message or something like that. So what kind of killer stat could you use? I mean, one that I use when I'm talking about speaking and presenting is the fact that, did you know 75% of the population actually suffer with speech anxiety? So that means 75% of you are going to be my captive audience. And you're like, oh, really? I didn't know that. And I'm like, yeah, I have the same. I'm actually dyslexic. an introverted extrovert. So it's something like that. It backs up. It gives you credibility and it backs up your story. Yeah, well, I mean, unless you might know a stat off the back, but if you don't, then something that is interesting. Brilliant. Well done, guys. So you should have got your killer stat, hopefully. Next thing, number two, is then to turn to the person next to you. And I want you to start with, did you know? Did you know? Tell them your killer stat. 30 seconds each, very quick, and then switch. Excellent. Thank you. Gosh, look, you're so engrossed in this. I love it. You don't want to stop talking. I love it. And that's it, right? It's why our friends are our friends, because we find them interesting. They bring something new and exciting to the table. We're learning all the time, and they're able to put whatever that knowledge is into our worlds and put it into perspective for us. So that is all about your key fact. We've got your story that we've done so far, and we've also got your fact, which has kind of made you credible and relatable as well. And this is what I was talking about in terms of that, what's in it for me. So really, we are animals, right? And that's what we do. When we meet another human, we kind of size them up as well. We'll think about, where in the pecking order? Are they above me or below me? And can they help me? What can they do for me? What value can they add to my lives? And that's what we talk about is, obviously, we want to spend our time wisely. It's the only commodity you can't buy more of, right? So are they going to listen to your talk, or should they do something else? There you go. So your hook, this brings me on to, is the way that we are going to draw people in and hook them, make sure that they don't just listen or sit up and listen to your presentation. So, and this could be the very first thing of any presentation. It could be literally the title of your presentation. It could be the first thing you actually introduce yourself with. It could be the actual name of your business as well. Think about some good business names like Victoria's Secrets. Oh, I'm already interested. What's the secret? Or Elon Musk, he bought a business recently to do with digging holes, and he thought he'd take the mickey out of it and call it the Boring Company. So I think they're both really good examples of luring people in. And that's what we need to think about. So effectively, your hook is your so what. Why should somebody care? Why should they come and actually listen to you in the first place? And we need to do what we need to do when we do that is think about our audience first. So we obviously understand our story. We know we are compelling and what we can bring to the table, but they don't. Maybe there's a gap that we can fill or some way that we can help them. And that's what we really need to think about with our hook. And it's really, like I said, this is your story here, your novel. Somebody actually said to me once, your life is like a book and you better make it worth reading. I thought, God, I better start doing some stuff then. but what we're talking about here really is like the cover of your book. We need to make it really compelling so people want to turn that first page and start reading. So let's have a little think about this. Next, obviously, exercise then, of course, because we love a good exercise, is getting you to have a little think about that hook. So what's in it for your audience? What's the so what? Why should they care? What's the real point that you want to land? Remember that people don't take much away. And this is going to be a snapshot thing, right? This is only like a sentence. This is your hook to lure people in. So have a little think about those. And if you're struggling, you nifty little tip I'm going to give you today is to go to thetitlegenerator.com, one of my favorite websites. And what you can do here is just put in three words. So if it was me, it'd be speaking, successful speaker, and I don't know, tips and something else. And what it does is chucks out a load of different potential hooks for you. So there you go. Have a little go at that. I'm going to give you a couple of minutes on the clock, and then we can come back. Excellent. So you should have a really compelling hook. What is the reason that people are going to listen to you? And I guess what we've been through today is, of course, our story. We've gone through our facts, and we've also got a hook. But it's all about playing around with things, a bit like what Netflix does. So I don't know if you know this, but this is what, if you've ever looked at your Netflix, they sometimes will change the covers of your films. I've been on there once, and one time it was blue, and then it was red. And that's what they're doing. They're trying and testing you guys as an audience to see what works best for you, what's the most compelling. And it's the same, we do it with dynamic advertising as well, testing lots of different creatives. And that's what I implore you guys to go away and do. I personally do lots of different talks about different things, and sometimes my story will change if I'm talking more to a speaking audience or if it's about mental health or LGBT or any of those different topics. You can imagine how my story might just change a little bit to fit to that audience. So I implore you guys to do the exact same. Now I'm going to bring us full circle back to my favorite storyteller, Steve Jobs. And why he's such a good storyteller is because he understood the value of storytelling. So he put his everything into it. He went and practiced, he had a coach, and he went and learnt. And it's the same for you guys. It's okay to do the exact same because it, at the end of the day, is really gonna make a difference. So, last but not least, we did our introduction at the very start, remember? And it was probably a bit like, hi, my name's John. I work for X company and I do this for X years, yeah? Hopefully we've progressed since then. We've learned something here today. So we're gonna get you guys to go off and do your introduction. And remember the three things that we've talked about already. Your hook, this shouldn't take long, it's like a 15 second, hook them in, one sentence. Then you might go, did you know? And tell them an interesting fact and make them sit up and want to listen to you. And then you're emotionally gonna take them on that journey with you through your story. And remember those things like details, remember tonality as well and how you can draw people in. And yeah, we're gonna hand it over to you to give you, so 3 minutes, you should be able to do that and then switch to the other person. I'll tell you when to switch, but yeah, last chance to have a little practice. Off you guys go. How do we find that? Good. So we can hear the people at home as well. So it was good, that's what she said. Good, okay. Anything else but good?
Excellent.
Oh, excellent. Oh, blimey, what did you tell her? Brilliant. Well, how are we doing at the back? I heard lots of laughter going on there anyway, so there was something clearly, someone's a very good, funny storyteller back there. Excellent. So to wrap things up then, I am going to play you guys a bit of a video. Because ultimately you came here to unboring your stories, right? And hopefully you have. I can see lots of good feedback. But I just want you to have a little watch of this because sometimes we need a bit of help to help us unboring those stories or help us speak or deliver with more impact or whatever that is that you're trying to achieve. And that is absolutely okay. And I think this is a really good demonstration to show you that just those little tweaks, it's those unforgotten things that can make a real difference and have a really big impact. So I'm gonna play this for you now.
Do to my sign?
I wrote the same, but in different words.
Thanks, love.
There you go. moment. So ultimately, there's so much to cover, right? There's the speaker, the story. There's so much more to this than we've ever been able to cover in an hour session. And like you just saw here, that sometimes it does take somebody else to come in and help you just tweak a few things or word things differently in order for you to have impact. So if you found today's session really interesting and you do want to take this further and you want to come and work with me, then these are the ways that you can get in contact with me. Of course, if you're in person, then I'm going to be staying around and you can have a little chat with me afterwards. So thank you so much, guys. It's been an absolute pleasure speaking with you. And I believe now we're going to be going to a Q&A.
Does anyone in the room have a question? If you do, please wait for the microphone to come to you. Just stick your hand up and we'll come over to you. If anyone online also has a question, please send it through on the chat function and we will ask if you in the room.
How do you manage yourself when listening to a bad story?
Oh God, I have to be honest, I'm like one of those people. I don't deal with it great. I probably should deal with it better. But I think I've learned to try and dig deep and empathize with them and try and grasp what they're trying to say, because I think that's empathy is really important. And as I said, sometimes I tell really bad stories as well. I'm going to admit it. and they're just, I get it. It's because I've not really thought about what I was really trying to achieve before I went and did it. So I can empathize with people telling bad stories. My face might say a different thing, but I'm trying to empathize inside. Yeah, go on.
I've got a question online here from Mason. Hi, Kate. Great session. Do you ever feel like your hook or story changes, or do you tend to keep the same one?
Yeah, thank you, Mason. As I said a bit earlier, I definitely change it. It is all about the audience and understanding the audience. We were talking about this earlier, weren't we? It's really about, you know, and that audience might change depending on what type of talk that is. And again, it's that resonance, isn't it? Getting that relatability, getting people, those neurons firing. So definitely, my story changes. That I've got multiple stories, a kind of a bucket of stories, if you wish, that I go to and pluck out whenever I need. And I know that I'm talking to a certain audience that will probably resonate with that one more so than that one. So absolutely, yes.
Thank you. Great session. Thank you very much. Yeah. Do you have any tips on telling stories about things you're not personally connected to? Ooh. So I'm thinking in a business environment, it could be a strategy that doesn't really resonate with your values, but it's your job to tell that story.
Yeah, I hear you. No, I do. The worst thing is when somebody else creates that presentation for you as well, because that's that other like layer of disconnect. You're like, what are these? So that's, I guess, one of the things was try and find something in it that resonates with you as a person. The reason why you're telling it is obviously because you're an expert in it. So if nothing else, it's that you're going to fall back on, is your knowledge and expertise. And somewhere within that, there will be a story of once upon a time you helped somebody out and they were able to grow their business by X percent or whatever it is. There'll be some form of nice story in there. But I do think as hands-on as you can get with the story, if somebody has created those slides for you, perhaps something like that, go and change them, tweak them, put your own images in, go and make sure that it really like flows as well with you, because you'll have a natural storytelling flow. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, thank you.
Cool, good.
Hi, Kate. Hey. Thank you so much for tonight. In great session. How do you save a boring story when you kind of halfway through realize someone's disengaged, or you perhaps had a great preparation and halfway through you're like, I need to salvage this and not dig a hole?
I love it. Great question, by the way. Love Thank that. You. I'm just too honest. And normally I'd cut it and go, do you know what? That was really boring. I think people like honesty. That's what I'm saying, authenticity. We like crave it. We don't want to hear about the person who just brags about themselves. We want the real person in the business room with us. So going, do you know what? Actually, scrap that. That was awful. I apologize for that. Let's start again and tell something different. But that's where Yeah, adding that. I actually build in the first 5-10 minutes for any of my meetings are normally chit-chat, bit of storytelling, getting to know people. That's why I do my self-deprecation mostly. And that's really why. And I would say most of those are quite interesting, to be honest. But yeah, sometimes you end up telling a bad story and you just have to go, oops. It's the same as if you trip up in the middle of a presentation, right? And you stumble on your words. You kind of either smooth over it or you go back and go, that wasn't actually what I meant to say. So yeah, similar kind of thing, I guess. No worries.
So you said you're an introvert to the extrovert. So how did you deal, coming out and start to speak to people and getting them engaged to your stories, if you had that social anxiety already there?
Yeah, well, thank you for your question. So I first have to blame my mum, because she sent me to acting school. She was like, what is wrong with this child? where they're big personalities, right? So they just didn't get why I was just cowering in the corner. So she sent me to acting school, which was petrifying. But it really did bring me out of my shell and start me on that journey to getting more comfortable around speaking. But actually what I found is, at acting school, it taught me some good fundamentals. But I found that I was like the joker then, and the kind of person who just got up and performed, and I wasn't being vulnerable. I wasn't being real. So that's what journey I'm on now, is trying to tap into that a little bit more. But in answer to your question, in terms of that introverted extrovert, pushing yourself to do things like acting are really good ways of getting yourself out of your comfort zone. And I do other things as well beforehand. I don't know if any of you saw me prepping beforehand. I might have looked a bit like a weirdo, because I was doing breath work. I was focusing on my intentions, the fact that I wanted to add value and benefit you all in some way. And I think all of these things are helping us change our mindset. If we can turn that thing from a threat to an opportunity, it becomes a lot more easier to manage. Hopefully that was what you... Yeah. I still sometimes have to G myself up as well, look in the mirror and give myself a good pep talk, tell myself off for being worried and scared or whatever it is. So that doesn't... I don't think that ever really goes away. And it's good because it means you care, right? If you weren't nervous or you weren't... then it really wouldn't matter. So it's a good thing.
So when you're doing a speech or you're talking to someone and you get a bit nervous, sometimes you might repeat yourself. How would you, what advice would you give someone to stop them doing that?
Oh, that is another really good question as well. Thank you for these. So yeah, taking a breath, I think the pause is so undervalued. I quite like the pause now. It makes people feel uncomfortable because they feel like they have to fill the gap. So I just add a long dramatic pause in there to help me regain my thoughts. Or there's some really good ways of, things like, that's a really good question. What I'm doing there is buying myself a little bit of time to think about my answer, whereas I might have been getting a bit of a flat, might be a difficult question. So all of these things to buy us a bit of time. And if you do make a mistake, like I said, honesty is the best policy, to go back and go, actually, didn't really mean that. Let me have a little think about that. We're all human as well. You are allowed to have a little think and give yourself a little time. But I think when you do your pauses, remembering to breathe as well. Sometimes we literally forget to breathe and want to run off stage. We want to get it over and done with as soon as possible and end. And that's almost the worst thing you can do. So trying to tell yourself that you enjoy it, smiling, actually, it lures you into a self-sense of happiness. We actually release endorphins when we smile. So when we smile, we're like, oh, actually, I'm enjoying this. Oh, yeah, remember, I'm the expert. I can do this. I can tell people what's going on. So I think all of these little things are going to really help. Brilliant. So thank you so much, guys. You have been excellent. I really value your participation. And everybody at home as well, thank you so much. Thank you.